Hello everyone, and today I'm here to review a science fiction short story known as Axiomatic by Greg Egan. So if you can see in the background right there, that's Greg Egan's book cover of his Axiomatic. This is a short story collection, but before you go on, if you think this is the discussion of the entire book itself, no, this is just the discussion or the review of the short story, which is entitled Axiomatic, okay? So before I begin, the last sci-fi short story review I think about 8 months ago, and in that video I discussed Greg Bear's Tangents, and yeah, before I said that I'll be discussing prioritizing first science fiction short stories which were jointly awarded by the Hugo and Nebula, but then I realized that that constraint is so restricting, so you know, from now on I'll just, you know, review any short story, science fiction short story that I've read. So by the way, I've read a lot actually during the Christmas break, but the problem is I couldn't upload. We don't have the unlimited internet to upload YouTube videos, so I can only do that when I'm, you know, doing my postdoc right here, okay? But anyway, let's go into Greg Egan's Axiomatic. So before we go to the short story proper, let's talk about the author first. So Greg Egan is actually a BS graduate in mathematics. In fact, he has a published works in math, you know, and he's very reclusive. In fact, he claims that there is no uploaded photo of him on the web, on the internet. And in fact, any attempts or any claims of pictures that is being him, those are actually fake. So I don't know if that's true, because yeah, Greg Egan is so reclusive that every time his science fiction works garners awards, he gets an award, he refuses, you know, to receive them. He refuses to attend to conventions and like that. He's sort of like the mathematician Gregory Perelman, the guy who proved the Poincaré conjecture. So Gregory Perelman was supposed to have like $1 million in his name for solving one of the millennium problems in mathematics. But then what happens is that he said the proving the problem was the reward in itself. So yeah, he didn't claim the prize. But anyway, going back to Greg Egan, okay, so this is one of his short stories. And in fact, many people claim that he is a very hardcore, hard science fiction writer. And in fact, some people claim that, you know, you need a PhD in physics to understand his work. So, of course, we don't have a problem there. I have a PhD in physics. But yeah, anyway, this short story, Axiomatic, it's not physics per se. It's in the realms of neuroscience, okay? And yeah, it's not that I think anyone can get into it. But yeah, his early works, I'm still gonna read them. I haven't read them, the novels in particular. They are really very, you know, into cosmology and physics, but I'll tackle that in some other time. So, Axiomatic, what is this short story? This short story is a brain hacking, you know, so this sci-fi trope where, you know, that you can do some things to alter your brain. So, you've seen this, you know, in like Hollywood popular media, like for example the premise of the sci-fi movie Inception, okay? But that's yeah, it's very minor. You plant an idea within a dream, and then that idea would soon define the person, would soon define his beliefs and so on. But all the way to the other end of the spectrum, the Matrix, for example, where, you know, the AIs, the robots control your brain, and you think, you know, everything that you have is your own, but then you're actually, everything that you're observing is actually being simulated so that they can harness you as their supply of power, okay? And in fact, in the Philippines, we have this science fiction movie entitled Instalado. It's a really very good movie, and I have a problem with the ending, which I'll talk about, but basically the premise is also that in the future, the education system is such that either you go to college, okay, the usual way that we do when we go to college, we take courses for 4 to 5 years, or if you're rich enough, you can have these things called Instalado, and then with that you will be called an Insta, okay? And it's a nice pun, because when you say Instalado, so you install something in your brain and then you become an Insta, what it does is, so you want, for example, you want to be a chemist, you buy an Insta to be a chemist. You want to be a mathematician, instant. You want to be a farmer, you buy that install thing, and you can have as many things as you want. Okay, and yeah, it's a very nice social commentary on the, you know, educational system in the Philippines, how, you know, those with money can do this and those without have a different set of, you know, the difference between public and private school. It's a good commentary on that. But yeah, on the sci-fi side, I have a problem with the ending because warning, if you haven't seen that movie, this will be in spoilers right here, but Instalado, the way it ended is that so now you have these people who have Insta, right? So now you have these people who took the effort, who did 4 to 5 years so that they can learn and they can master their craft. And then there are these people who has the money. If you have the money, they can do that like in seconds, within minutes, okay? So the thing is, in the future, how do we react to such availability of such technologies, you know? So if you have like people who can buy these installations instantly, do their learning, do their knowledge, is it inferior to those whose knowledge is obtained by working hard for 4 to 5 years? Okay, and again, in that movie, they really showed that if you work for 4 to 5 years or if you do the installation, there's no difference between your knowledge, okay, between what you can do. And yeah, so the movie ended in a way that I don't like, because what it did is, it's like a cop-out, you know? So instead of like it being open-ended, they took the easy route and they said, Insta is very nice, but then in the end, you get crazy or you get sick when you do the Insta. So better don't do the Insta because in the future, you will get crazy. So in my opinion, they shouldn't have done that, you know? They should have, you know, made it open-ended and then let the audience ask, like, okay, so if we have this technology, is it like what happens to our educational system? What happens to our acquisition of knowledge, you know? Because I think in the future, if we can do that, I think it will really be very efficient, you know? But yeah, that's just me. But anyway, let's go back to Axiomatic. So Axiomatic also has these ideas of altering your consciousness or the way your brain is wired. So it begins with this guy named Mark Carver. So Mark Carver is like the protagonist, the main character of this short story. And so he went into this place that, you know, sells these things known as the Axiomatics, okay? And in Axiomatics, so you I don't know, you inject it in your nose or you're like, you smell it like a drug. But the thing is, it depending on the drug that you buy, it can alter things that is very different to who you were or how you were brought up as a kid or how your belief system, how your morality, how your common sense was melded by the society that you grew up in. So for example, you grew up to be a Christian, for example, and then, you know, you don't get why there are people who, you know, don't believe in Jesus, or you don't get how come other people believe in some other belief system, or how come some people, you know, believe in Satan and so on, when it's very obvious that, you know, you need to accept Jesus in your heart. So the nice thing is Axiomatic, it gives you this medicine so you can try it. For example, you buy the medicine for, I don't know, atheism. So you snort it in your nose and then you can set the time. So for example, this Axiomatic will activate for one day. Okay, so for one day, I want to experience what it is like being an atheist. And this is not just something, so when you drink this, at least the book claims, when you drink the, or when you take the Axiomatic, it really rewires your brain in such a way that for the time period that you took this medicine, it would really seem as if that is your core belief system. So you will now be able to sit within the, you know, within the shoes of an atheist, for example. Or for example, if you have, let's say, some belief system where some people think that abortion is, let's say, bad, and then some people would think that abortion is a good thing. So if you are one of those people who think that abortion is a good thing, and then you can't get, why are those people think that abortion is good? Why? So you can buy Axiomatic and then take it for like, I don't know, an hour, and then it's really, oh, that makes sense, like that. Or you can do it the other way around. You are someone who thinks abortion is good. You don't get people who are anti-abortionists. So you take the Axiomatic for that idea, and then you drink it for, let's say, one day, and then you understand, now I get why abortion is bad. So yeah, so that's the premise, okay, Axiomatic. So now Mark Carver, he ordered a custom designed Axiomatic, a custom made medicine, which he paid for like $400. So that's a huge amount of money, considering this short story was written in like what, 1995 or something, mid 90s. Okay, so it's an expensive money that he paid for that Axiomatic, and it turns out this Axiomatic is he wanted to take this because his morality is getting in the way of something that he thinks he wants to do. Okay, and so this guy Mark Carver, what happened is that he had a wife named Amy who one time went into the bank, and then it wasn't clear. Everyone was like, was told to, you know, get down, and then for some reason his wife was targeted by one of the guys who robbed the bank, and then his wife Amy was killed, was shot. Okay, and it took many years, and then eventually he kept on following that story. So he was told that he was told by there were like some footages. He was told by the policeman that actually this guy named Miller, he was the person who killed your wife. But the thing is, Miller like made a deal with the court, you know. Along the lines of this, so Miller asked the court to, he says he will testify against his, you know, his fellow robbers, but you know, you make my punishment a little lighter. So his collaborators were like, I don't know, imprisoned for life, and then he was like just imprisoned for I think 5 years or 6 years. And yeah, so during those time period, you know, Mark Carver was really having this internal debate within himself whether or not it is the right thing to do to take his revenge upon the killer's name is what's his name? Paul Anderson, but his family name is Anderson. Patrick, yeah, there you go. Patrick Anderson. Okay, so Mark was thinking, huh, is it really worth it to, you know, kill Mark Carver? I mean, for revenge. And then he said he has this. He was brought up in this particular way where he thinks that no, revenge is not the answer. You know, revenge doesn't solve everything. Even after you killed the killer, it wouldn't be something that Amy would have wanted. You know, he would have wanted you to move on and so on. Okay, so he for all these years he kept on thinking about these things. He always has this internal debate, but then eventually Patrick Anderson was released in prison, and then he was still having this debate. But then he really had this conviction that no, I don't have it in me to kill Patrick Anderson. But then he said, what if I take an axiomatic that, you know, that makes it feel okay within myself to kill someone for revenge? Okay, so again, some people think that way. Some people, you know, justice is served well when you kill the killers. That's why we have some countries, I don't know, have like they punish you with a death sentence when you are caught, for example. Okay, but then some people are against that. Some people are into rehabilitation and stuff, and of course Mark Carver, our protagonist, believed in the latter. Okay, he believes in revenge not solving anything. And so what he did is, that's why he went to this axiomatic thing, because he got that custom medicine called Life is Cheap. Okay, and so that he would, you know, his brain would be rewired in such a way that it will be okay. You know, he would have this morality, or he would have this thinking where it's okay to kill for revenge or to kill for justice. Okay, so that's what he did. He got, and in fact, he was really having second thoughts the moment he already got it. He's like, okay, I already got it, but then he threw it away first in the garbage can. But then later on, he changed his mind. He got it back, and also he already had a gun. You know, he purchased a gun, and he really thought this through, because he said, yeah, I purchased a gun. He was really paranoid because he's like, yeah, the police knows that I bought a gun. Won't they think wouldn't they find it weird that the time that I got the gun was also the time that Patrick Anderson got out of prison? But he said, but that was already a long time ago, so maybe they don't mind, or maybe they know, but they don't think it's a necessary thing to look into. But yeah, he got the gun, and then he got the medicine thing. So the cool thing is, he opened the medicine, and then it's like there's like a program thing that is connected to the thing that you buy, the Axiomatic, and then it will ask you, do you speak in English? And then you will say yes, and then it will give you an instructions. Okay, so it will say, this Axiomatic, how long would you want this Axiomatic to last? And in Mark Carver said he wanted it to last for 3 days. And then afterwards, he took it, okay? And so the nice thing is, the short story, I thought it, at first it would go into this, you know, it would follow his train of thought where you would see a transformation between how he viewed killing someone for justice, and then at first it's okay, and then how that internal debate, how that turns into it being from being not okay to being okay, but it doesn't, okay? It actually like jumps into the scene itself where he goes to Patrick Anderson's place. And so I like that because it gives you this vague sense. It gives you these open questions whether or not is the Axiomatic really effective, or is Mark Carver, is he really like that as a person, you know? Like, is his, what if deep inside he really wanted to kill for revenge, but then he's being, you know, he's being suppressed by these ideas around him and so on. So I love that he doesn't have that internal debate going to the place when he wanted to kill Patrick. So he went there, he went through to Patrick Anderson's place, he had a gun, he said, open the door, go inside, and so on. And then he said, I know you killed. So at first, Patrick Anderson didn't recognize him because it's been years since he was released. But then when he said, I know you killed your wife, like Patrick Anderson remembered, and then he said, actually, I didn't kill it. It was Miller. Okay, so Miller is the guy who was convicted in place of Patrick Anderson. But in reality, it was actually Patrick Anderson who killed the wife. He said, I didn't kill it. But then Mark Carver shot his foot, you know, pack. And then Patrick Anderson was like, oh fuck you! Why did you do that? What the fuck? Yeah, I killed your wife, and then after this, I'm gonna kill you, you motherfucker. He's like that. He's a big man, you know. And then Mark Carver is a little bit afraid, but of course he had a gun. So he's like, why? Tell me what happened. And then Patrick Carver, so the gun was already on his head. And then, Patrick Anderson, the gun was already on his head. And then he was like, I don't know, man. It was like, I don't know. I don't know why I did it. She just moved. And then it was getting really bad. Like, there was no cash. Like, the timer's almost out. Like, the police are coming. You know, it just happened, you know. And then he's like, no, why? Tell me why it happened. And then Patrick Anderson was like, it just happened. You know, it just is. You know, when you had like a bad temper or something, you know, your wife was just in the wrong place at the wrong time. And then, you know, suddenly Mark Carver had this realization, I think I get what he meant. You know, like sometimes when he and Amy, his wife before, he had a recollection, sometimes when they had a fight, and sometimes he's so angry he wants to kick something, and then the dog just happens to be there, so he kicked the dog. So he's like, I think it's kind of like that, you know. So the dog was just like being in the wrong place at the wrong time, and so was his wife, and then that's why she got killed. Okay, and then in that moment, slowly, you know, he realized. So the Axiomatic medicine that he bought was life is cheap. Okay, so the thing is, he realized now when he was remembering his wife, like, you know, I think that was, it doesn't matter, you know, like she's dead, like. Like, yeah, I will do this revenge thing, or I'm always thinking about her, but it doesn't matter. She's already dead. She doesn't, you know, like, she doesn't feel anymore. She just died a long time ago. And so the nice thing is, the life is cheap Axiomatic actually did the effect not only on the killer, okay, because he wanted to, for 3 days, he wanted to feel that life is cheap, that life is worthless, it's okay to kill, but then it sort of backfired, okay? So not only did he think of that on the killer, he began thinking that about his wife. It's like, our marriage is like nothing, you know. It's like, in the end, she just died for nothing, like, you know, just nothing. It's because of nothing. And then this guy, this killer right here, he just shot him, you know, Patrick Anderson. And so Patrick Anderson died, his gun had a silencer, so he got out of there, he was innocent. Like, the police didn't find out anything about what he did because he had this, you know, futuristic bullets that dissolves. But anyway, that's not relevant. So the thing is, He got out of it, okay? And then he went home, and then that's it. When he went home and then the medicine expired, okay, he realized that during the night when he killed Patrick Anderson, that's like the most amount of peace that he had for years, okay? So for years he's been thinking about the death of his wife, whether or not he's gonna do this revenge. But then on that particular, you know, a span of time when he drank the Axiomatic, when he was wired to think that life is cheap, that was the, he was so peaceful during that time, man. And so, yeah, so the ending of the book was like, he went back to this guy who was selling the Axiomatic, and he was like, hey, nice to see you again. And then he's like, yeah, give me some of that. And of course, I think it's implied that that axiomatic, because the axiomatic, once you drink it, you can set the range of the ideals that you want to have. You want to set it, in his case, initially he set it for 3 days, but of course it's implied that the next batch he would set it for life, okay? So that's the thing. And the nice thing about this short story is that there's actually a short film by this guy named K.S. Kuperis, okay? And it's really very, very well-made short film. I'm gonna give you the link down below. This K.S. Kuperis guy, he made some minor changes. For example, instead of being Mark Carver, the main protagonist, he made it, I think, Marisa Carver. So he made it into a girl, a strong woman character. And so Amy and Marisa, they are like homosexuals in love with each other. But those were the things that he changed. But the entire gist is in there in the short film. It was nicely done. The thing is, okay, this is what I find weird about the movie. I don't know if Kuperis did this on purpose or he just made a minor mistake, but I think this is a very major thing to miss, okay? So if I don't know if he did it on purpose or he had his own reinterpretation of the story, but yeah, watch this short clip right here. I'm gonna put it, I don't know, on this side. I'm gonna put the clip right here. So watch it for a while and then I'm gonna shut up.
My mistake was thinking that the inside I gained would remain when the implant wore off. It hasn't.
Okay. So I hope that... So you see that. So in the book, okay, let me read the quote from the book. So in the book, it says the following. My one mistake was thinking that the insight I gained would simply vanish when the implant cut out. It hasn't, okay? So very important word. So in here in the book, it says the insight that you got in after drinking the axiomatic, the main character thought that it would vanish. It hasn't. In the short film, it says it would remain. It hasn't. I think that's not the point. I think that's wrong, okay? I think I hold to the original story. So the thing is, Mark Carver thought that it would vanish, okay? And it hasn't, okay? So he drank the axiomatic, he drank it for 3 days, he thought that those ideas, those new ideas that you previously don't have and then was already there because of the axiomatic, he thought it would only last for 3 days. After that, it won't be gone, okay? After that, he would be like, murder is bad, you know, I am morally high, revenge is wrong, and so on. It did not vanish. In other words, it remained there. And I think this is important that it remains, because it opens the short story. So instead of it vanishing, it remained. Instead of the other way around, instead of it remaining, it vanished, as the short film wanted to pursue. I think the original one is more important, because it invites the reader to the following question. It invites the reader to think whether or not did it really vanish? I mean, did Mark Carver think that it would vanish or it didn't? Or had it been there in the first place? So in other words, I mean, did the axiomatic, was it the one that gave him that idea in the first place? Or was it already there in his being? And then was it like repressed? He was trying to repress it. And then when the axiomatic was there, was it some sort of like a placebo? You know, it's like, I drink axiomatic, then I am going to do this. But what if it's just a placebo? What if deep inside it was really like that, okay? And so yeah, it opens this very, very nice idea of, you know, how, like, as a person, that, like, who are we truly? Like, are we defined by, you know, the belief system around us, the society that we are being melded into? But are we really, when we are born, do we really have this, you know, preset numbers of morality where, yes, the society around you, you know, can meld you, can influence you on who you will become in the future. But, you know, if those are gone, you would, you know, go back to this thing that you really are, okay, when you are born. But again, we don't know that. That's like, that's why neuroscience is very interesting. You know, it talks about the, you know, how, what the mind really is, what individuality really is. But yeah, anyway, it's a very good short story, man. I invite you. So even after watching this, and then if intrigues you, go read the story. It fleshes out a lot of things. It talks about a lot of some other stuff that you can do with the axiomatic. But yeah, I like it. It has a very simple premise. it has the, you know, the relationship between the sci-fi was there. It wasn't metaphorical or something. The sci-fi is it's not soft, you know. I mean, the technology was there, and then Greg Egan took it, and then how it would interact to that society that Mark Carver was living in. Okay, and it's really very good. You know, it's very nice to think in the future if for example neuroscience advances to the point where this something like this could be done, you know, how would we react? Like, do you think it would be legal to do these things? Like, you know, to drink something, to drink an ideal that you didn't have previously, like, is it okay to do that? So forget the debate whether or not it's your idea or are you born with it or not. Forget about that. Like, think about whether it is, you know, you find it in yourself to be acceptable, you know, to have. So you have a set of belief system, and then you drink a medicine or you take in a axiomatic, you snort it like that, and then it would, for temporarily or in a long term, no, it's up to you how long you want it to run, change the way your brain would think into ways that, you know, you never thought you would be thinking. Okay, so yeah, I really love that short story. So I'm gonna give it, so from here on out, I think I'm gonna give ratings on the short stories I've read. So I think this one I'm gonna give it like a solid 8 out of 10, I think. And yeah, so to give you an idea, my 10 out of 10 sci-fi, like, for me so far, I read a lot of sci-fi. The best science fiction short story that I've read, my favorite, so like my 10s, for example, is Isaac Asimov's Nightfall, All You Zombies by Robert Heinlein. So those types of caliber. Okay, so this is good. 8 over 10 is good. Okay, so yeah, I'm gonna give ratings. So I'll try to do this science fiction short story reviews every week, okay, if I can. But yeah, so thank you so much. If you've reached the end of the video, thank you so much for taking the time to watch this, and I'll see you next time for some science fiction discussions. Bye-bye.